Good afternoon, students.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Okay, all of you, please switch on your videos. So today we have one more seminar. So I invite Vidur to present the topic based on Ampere circuit law and one of its application. So you can start it now.
So good afternoon to all. Today I am going to take seminar on Ampere circuit law and its applications on solenoid. Ampere circuit law. This law states that line integral of magnetic field around any closed circuit is equal to mu zero times the total current I flowing through the circuit. The equation is closed integral B dot dl is equal to mu zero I, where mu zero is the permeability of free space and I is the current. Solenoid. It is a device which is formed by an insulated copper wire when wound tightly in the form of a cylinder. This is the image of a solenoid. Now, the types of solenoid and uses of it. First one is lifting solenoid. It is used for lifting objects like steel, iron, and some ferromagnetic materials. Second one is brake solenoid. It is used in the braking system of automobile for the purpose of accurate parking. And the third one is the traction solenoid, which is used in traction of mechanical devices and opening and closing of various valves so as to perform automatic control tasks. These are the images of these types of solenoid. First one is lifting solenoid, second one is braking solenoid, and the last is traction solenoid. Magnetic field due to long solenoid. For that, first of all, we can consider a solenoid with current I flowing through it. When the current passes through the solenoid, magnetic field is produced, and the magnetic field lines produced are of similar to that of bar magnet. That is, inside the magnet, the magnetic field lines direction is from north to south. Outside the magnet is from north to south, and inside the magnet is from south to north. To calculate the magnetic field, we can use Ampere circuit law. For that, we need an Ampere loop in the form of a square or rectangle with sides A, B, C, D. Now we can apply Ampere circuit law in this Ampere loop. According to Ampere circuit law, closed integral B dot dl is equal to mu zero I. The line integral closed integral vector B dot vector dl for the loop A, B, C, D is the sum of four integrals. Then closed integral A to B vector B dot vector dl plus closed integral B to C vector B dot vector dl plus closed integral C to D vector B dot vector dl plus closed integral D to A vector B dot vector dl vector dl. Since the dot product of the two vectors is the cos of the angle between them, we can substitute closed integral A to B BDL cos theta, plus closed integral b to c b dl cos theta plus closed integral c to d b dl cos theta plus closed integral d to a b dl cos theta. In this Hamiltonian loop, a to d and b to c are perpendicular to that of magnetic field, so their angle is 90 degree, then cos 90 degree is zero. So in this equation, second term and third term, fourth term can be cancelled, and cos 0 is equal to 1, then the equation becomes closed integral a to b bdl plus closed integral c to d bdl. Since cd of the loop is outside the solenoid, the magnetic field around cd is 0. Then closed integral bdl is equal to mu 0 I, and this equation can be applied for the solenoid with one turn. So for n number of turns, the equation becomes closed integral bdl is equal to n into mu 0 I. Now b is a constant and it can be taken outside, then b closed integral dl is equal to n into mu 0 I, and derivative of a function this dl is l, so b dot b into l is equal to n into mu 0 I. So we have to calculate magnetic field. The L can be taken into the arches. So B is equal to N into mu 0 I by L. Since N by L, that is number of turns per unit length, is small letter N, the final equation we will get as B is equal to mu 0 NI, where B is equal to magnetic field, mu 0 is the permeability of free space, N is the number of turns per unit length, and I is the current. Factors affecting magnetic field: 1. Number of turns per unit length, 2. Amount of current, and 3. Is the material inside the cylinder. When a soft iron core is present, is placed in a solenoid, the strength of the magnetic field can be increased. That's all from me. Thank you.
Okay, Vidur, it's a nice presentation with some extra points he included about the solenoid. So now it's the time for discussion. If you have any doubt regarding with this topic about the Ampere circuital law and its application, you can ask and clarify it with Vidur.
So can I ask questions?
Wait 1 minute. We can check whether they have any doubt. Did anyone have any doubt regarding with this topic? I think no. Okay, now you can ask question to them.
So first question is for to Punya.
Okay.
Can you state Ampere circuital law?
Line integral of magnetic field around any closed loop is equal to mu 0 times the current flowing through the surface.
Are you satisfied with the answer, Vidur?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Now to Aditya.
Okay.
Can you give 3 types of solenoid which I have said?
Braking solenoid, traction solenoid, lifting solenoid.
Is it right, Vidur?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Now
anything else?
Antony.
Okay.
Can you say the final equation of magnetic field due to long solenoid?
The question is to Antony. Antony, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Magnetic field due to solenoid. What is the final equation for magnetic field experienced or exerted by the solenoid? You can pass the same question to anybody else.
Sunandana.
To whom?
Is equal to N mu 0 I.
For Antony, there's a imposition for 5 times.
Okay. Okay. So here we were discussing about the Ampere circuit law and its one of its application regarding with that of the solenoid. Okay, and Ampere circuit law in magnetism is similar to that of the Gauss's law in electrostatics. Okay, so that's all about the topic. So now let us continue with our class. Okay. Yes.
He did not explain the new topic, ma'am. Like the three solenoids.
Ah, yes, about the three solenoids. This
what
is an
type of solenoid?
Yes, Achyut, what is your question?
The three types of solenoids.
The three types of, you don't need to study about these three types of solenoid. Here, he present this topic as an extra information. Okay, as a part of the seminar, he collect an extra information that is lifting solenoid, tracking solenoid and braking solenoid. It's an extra information. You don't need to study about its uses and its names and all. Okay. So now we can move to our next topic. So all of you write the next topic, dipole in uniform magnetic field. So before that, I want to continue with our chapter. So all of you write the next topic, dipole in uniform magnetic field. Dipole in uniform magnetic field. Dipole in an uniform magnetic field. Dipole in a uniform magnetic field. So in order to explain the dipole in a uniform magnetic field, first of all, consider a uniform magnetic field. Consider a uniform magnetic field. And place a dipole in this uniform magnetic field. Consider a uniform magnetic field and place a dipole in this uniform magnetic field. What do you mean by dipole?
Ball.
Can you recall the dipole?
It's a pair of equal and opposite charges.
Yes, that is in electrostatic. It is a pair of equal and opposite charges separated by a small distance. So in magnetism, dipole means a magnetic material with the two opposite poles. It can be north pole and the south pole. Okay. Or here we have south, because magnetic uniform magnetic field lines are always directed from north to south outside the magnet. So here it is south, this is north. So in magnetism, dipole means it is a magnetic material with the two opposite poles, that is south pole and north pole, or north pole and south pole. In electrostatics, dipole means two equal and opposite charge that is separated by a small distance. But in magnetism, we are studying about the magnetic material with the two poles, that is north pole and the south pole. So here, in order to derive the expression for dipole in a uniform magnetic field, first we consider a uniform magnetic field and place a dipole inside this uniform magnetic field. So tell me, students, what happens to this dipole when it is placed in a uniform magnetic field? What happens to this dipole when we are place it in a uniform magnetic field? Try to guess.
Experience a force.
Very good. It experiences a force. As a result of this, what happens to dipole? It experiences a force. So it undergoes a rotation inside this magnetic field. and this rotational effect is known as dash. What is that?
Torque.
Okay, so the same thing we are going to explain here. Here we are consider the uniform magnetic field. Inside this uniform magnetic field, we place a magnetic dipole. Magnetic dipole means it is a magnetic material that consists of two opposite poles, a north pole and a south pole. So when we place a dipole in a uniform magnetic field, it experiences a force and undergoes a rotation. So when we place the magnetic dipole in a uniform magnetic field, it experiences a force and undergoes the rotation. It experiences a force and undergoes a rotation. And this rotational effect of the magnetic dipole is known as torque. And this rotational effect of the magnetic dipole is known as torque. Then, what is the expression for torque in a magnetic field? And this torque is given by, what is the expression for torque in magnetic field? Tau is equal to, unmute and say, I want the answer from you.
Cos theta.
Tau is equal to, only cos theta.
MB cos theta.
Tau is equal to MB cos theta. So here we place a dipole in a magnetic field. When we place the dipole in a magnetic field, experiences a force. As a result, it undergoes a rotation. This rotational effect is known as torque. Then the expression for torque in a magnetic field is given by tau is equal to MB cos theta.
MB cos theta or sin theta?
MB sin theta. So is equal to MB sine theta. So is equal to MB sine theta. The rotational effect of the dipole in a magnetic field is given by tau is equal to MB sine theta. And what is M represents in this equation? M?
Magnetic.
Yes, magnetic dipole moment. And what is B?
Magnetic field.
Magnetic field. And sine theta is the angle between that of the magnetic dipole moment and that of the field. But here, the rotation is very small. Okay, the rotation of the magnetic dipole inside this uniform magnetic field is very small. Since the rotation of the dipole is very small, here we can approximate the value. Since the rotation of the dipole is small, we can take sine theta is approximately equal to theta. Here the rotation of dipole inside the uniform magnetic field is small. So we can take sine theta is approximately equal to theta. It is due to the rotational effect produced by the dipole in a uniform magnetic field is small. We can take the sine theta is approximately equal to theta. So our equation 1 becomes tau is equal to MB. Instead of sine theta, we can write
theta.
So tau is equal to MB theta. This is our equation number 2. Yes?
Ma'am, in the starting, can you say the first sentence again? They consider a uniform magnetic field and place.
We consider a uniform magnetic field and place a magnetic dipole. And place a magnetic dipole in this uniform magnetic field. Okay, here we consider a uniform magnetic field and place a magnetic dipole inside this uniform magnetic field. So when we place a magnetic dipole in this uniform magnetic field, it experiences a force. As a result, it undergoes a rotation, and this rotational effect is known as torque. Then the expression for torque in a uniform magnetic field is given by tau is equal to mb sin theta, where m is the magnetic dipole moment, b is the magnetic field, and sin theta is the angle between them. But here the rotation of the dipole inside the magnetic field is small, so we can take sin theta is approximately equal to theta. So equation 1 becomes tau is equal to mb theta. Okay, so now we are going to recall some concept that you are already studied in plus 1. Okay, we can recall some concept. So for that, what is the equation for calculating the force experienced by an object? Force, how we can calculate the force?
Ma.
Yes, F is equal to ma. F is equal to ma. Now, what is the rotational analog of this force? This F is equal to ma is a linear equation. But here, if the object is undergoes a rotation, what is the rotational analog or the rotational term representing the force? The rotational effect of the force is represented by?
Tau.
This is the rotational analog of force, tau. Similarly, what is the rotational analog of mass? We know that ma, where m is the mass, a is the acceleration. What is the rotational analog for mass of an object? Already studied in plus one physics. Any idea? It is moment of inertia. Okay, the rotational analog of mass is moment of inertia. It is represented by I. Okay, so the rotational analog of force is tau. The rotational effect of an object in a magnetic field is tau. Similarly, the mass, the rotational analog of mass of an object is moment of inertia. It is represented by I. This I is not the current, moment of inertia. Moment of inertia. Okay. Now, what is the rotational analog of acceleration? This A is represents the acceleration for linear equation. If the object is undergo a rotational motion, what about this term acceleration? It is not symbol the acceleration. We are call it by another name. Rotational analog of acceleration is angular acceleration. The rotational analog of acceleration is angular acceleration. It is represented by alpha. So this alpha is represents angular acceleration. Okay, so we get another equation for tau, that is tau is equal to I alpha. So these are the rotational analog for the term F is equal to ma. The rotational analog of F is tau. The rotational effect of the force is known as torque. It is represented by tau. Similarly, the rotational representation of mass of an object is moment of inertia. It is represented by the term I. And the rotational analog of the representation of acceleration is angular acceleration. It is represented by the letter alpha. So here we have another expression for tau. Tau is equal to I alpha. Did you remember an equation like this? Tau is equal to I alpha. Already studied in the previous year. Okay. So here we have tau is equal to mb theta. Tau is equal to mb theta. Then when we are consider the rotational effect of the force of an object, if we are consider the rotational analog of the force of an object, we have tau is equal to I alpha. The rotational force acting on an object is given by tau is equal to I alpha. This is our equation number 3. Now we can compare this equation number 2 and 3. The LHS of both equations are same. Here tau is equal to mb theta And in equation number 3, tau is equal to I alpha. So we can compare this equation. So it becomes, we can equate equation number 2 and 3.
Ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, when we consider the analog of?
Rotational analog of object. When we consider the rotational analog of force experienced on the object. Here the object is dipole. So after the second step, you can write, when we consider the rotational analog of force experienced on the dipole. When we consider the rotational analog of force experienced on the dipole, we have tau is equal to I alpha. Okay. So when we consider the rotational analog of force experienced on the dipole, or the force experienced on the object. Here the object means the dipole that we are placed inside the uniform magnetic field. We have tau is equal to I alpha. This equation you are already studied in plus one physics. That is what is we are derived here. So here we are going to equate the equation 2 and 3. We are going to equate the equations 2 and 3. Because the LHS of the both equation 2 and 3 are same. Tau is equal to mb theta. Then by equation 3 we have tau is equal to I alpha. So we can write I alpha is equal to mb theta. So I alpha is equal to mb theta. Okay. The rotational analog of the force experienced on the dipole is given by tau is equal to I alpha. So here we are equate the two equations 2 and 3 because the LHS of the two equations are same. So here we have I alpha is equal to mb theta. But in your textbook, you can see a negative sign here. Why? Why this negative sign is appeared here? Here we are consider a uniform magnetic field and we place a dipole inside this uniform magnetic field. Okay. So when we place a magnetic field or when we place a dipole inside this uniform magnetic field, it experiences a force and it undergoes a rotation. It undergoes a rotation when we place in a uniform magnetic field. So initially the dipole in a horizontal direction. If you are placing this dipole in a uniform magnetic field, it undergoes a rotation. So it becomes like this. It undergoes a rotation and the shape of the dipole becomes like this. But at the same time.
How many are present?
Only 26 students are here.
I can see only 8 plus 10, 12 students. So I think you have to mark absent all the rest.
Okay, sir. Sure, sir.
You be strict. Mark them absent if they are not. Carry on.
Okay, sir. So initially the dipole is horizontal to that of the direction of the uniform magnetic field. So when we place this dipole moment placed in a uniform magnetic field, it experiences a force. As a result, it undergoes a rotation and that rotational effect is known as torque. So after the rotation, the position or the shape of the dipole is like this. But at the same time, it experiences a restoring torque. At the same time, it experiences a restoring torque due to the opposing polarity. At the same time, it is experienced whenever it is undergoes a rotation, the south pole is having a tendency to towards here, or it is undergoes a rotation, it becomes here, and the north pole is here. So it undergoes a restoring torque. then again it is back to its initial position, that is in the horizontal position. So initially it experiences a force and undergoes a rotation, that is what is known as the rotational effect of the dipole, that is torque. But whenever it is undergoes a rotation, at the same time it experiences a restoring torque, then it is back to its initial position. So that is why here we are taking or giving a negative sign. So this negative sign is due to the presence of restoring torque that is experienced by the dipole. Is it clear? So this is not clear?
No, ma'am, can you explain once
more? Okay, once again I will explain it. So initially the magnetic dipole, the position of the magnetic dipole is like this. Okay, this is our uniform magnetic field, and we place a dipole here, here with the south pole, and here it is with the north pole. Okay, so when we place a magnetic dipole in a uniform magnetic field, it experiences a force. As a result, it undergoes a rotation. It undergoes a rotation inside this uniform magnetic field. So the shape of the dipole becomes like this. The shape of the dipole becomes like this. Okay, here we have south pole and here we have north pole. Due to the opposing polarity, because this north pole is repels each other, we know that the like poles are repels each other and unlike poles are only attract. So whenever it is undergoes a rotation like this, the north pole of this magnetic dipole is repelled by this north side of the uniform magnetic field. Due to this opposing polarity, the magnetic dipole is experience a restoring torque. Okay, it is again undergoes a rotation, and that rotation bring this dipole back to its original position. Is it clear now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So initially the magnetic dipole is in the horizontal direction. Whenever it is undergoes a rotation, the position of the magnetic dipole is like this. But this north pole of the magnet is repelled by the north pole of the our magnetic field. North pole of our magnetic field. As a result, it is rotate again, and that restoring torque is bring the magnetic dipole to its original position. Is it clear now? So due to that restoring torque, here we can put a negative sign. I alpha is equal to minus mb theta. Or from this equation we can write the angular acceleration alpha is equal to, can you say the equation? But our equation becomes I alpha is equal to minus mb theta, or angular acceleration alpha is equal to
minus mb theta by I.
Yes, very good. Minus mb theta divided by I. I alpha is equal to minus mb theta, or the angular acceleration alpha is equal to minus mb theta divided by I. So we can give the equation number 4. This is our equation number 4. Now, what is the equation for angular acceleration? This is also you are already studied in plus one physics. Can you recall the equation for calculating the angular acceleration? What is acceleration? If you don't know, you don't need to be bothered about it. We can start it from our basics. What do you mean by acceleration?
Reduction in velocity.
Very good. It is the rate of change of velocity, right? In the linear terms, we can say that angular acceleration is the rate of change of velocity. So what is velocity? What is velocity?
Change in displacement.
Displacement. Rate of change of displacement is known as velocity. That is, we know that displacement is represented by x. Then velocity is represented by v. Velocity is represented by v. And we know that velocity is the rate of change of displacement. Velocity is the rate of change of displacement, or velocity v is equal to dx divided by dt. So we are going to discuss about acceleration. This is linear acceleration, not the angular acceleration. The acceleration is the rate of change of velocity. Acceleration is rate of change of velocity, that is dv by dt is known as our acceleration, or that is equal to d by dt of what is v? D by dt of
dx by
dt. Yes, dx by dt, d by dt of dx by dt. So what is our acceleration becomes? A is equal to d into dx by dt into dt. D into dx become yes, d square x. So the acceleration become d square x divided by dt into dt. Dt into dt
square.
Dt square. Okay, d square x divided by dt square. Okay, so this is the expression for linear acceleration. This is the expression for linear acceleration. Similarly, we have angular displacement is the angular displacement. And this angular displacement is represented by the term theta. Okay, all these terms we are already studied in physics, plus one physics. The angular displacement is represented by theta. And angular velocity is the, if the object is under the rotational motion, we have to consider, we need to consider the angular velocity. Angular velocity is represented by omega. Okay, omega is known as angular velocity. So if displacement or the velocity, the linear velocity is the rate of change of displacement. Similarly, students, can you guess a definition for angular velocity? What is angular velocity, omega?
Rate of change of angular displacement.
Yes, it is the rate of change of angular displacement. So we know that in linear velocity, v is equal to rate of change of displacement. So similarly, the angular velocity omega, the angular velocity omega is the rate of change of displacement, that is d theta divided by dt. Okay, similarly we have angular acceleration. Can you guess the definition for angular acceleration then? Linear acceleration is the rate of change of velocity. Then what is angular acceleration? What is angular acceleration then?
Rate of change of angular velocity.
Yes, it is the rate of change of angular velocity. That is d omega divided by dt. Just compare to that of our linear equation. Here we are going to find an expression for angular acceleration alpha. So angular acceleration alpha means it is the rate of change of angular velocity. Okay, angular acceleration alpha is equal to d omega divided by dt. Okay. So again, the angular acceleration alpha is equal to d omega by dt. That is d by dt of omega. What is the value of angular velocity? Rate of change of velocity. What is that? D by dt of omega. What is the value of omega? Unmute and say, no problem.
D theta by dt.
Yes, it is d theta by dt. Okay, so here we are deriving an expression for angular acceleration. Angular acceleration means It is the rate of change of angular velocity. Angular velocity is represented by omega, and omega is equal to the rate of change of angular displacement. That is, omega is equal to d theta by dt. So by substituting all these values, we get an expression for angular acceleration. That is, alpha is equal to d by dt of d theta by dt. So what is angular acceleration? Alpha then d by dt of d theta by dt. Yes. It is
d square theta by dt also.
Yes, d square theta divided by dt square. D square theta by dt square. This is the expression for angular acceleration. You are already studied this expression in plus one physics. That is what is I am asking here. Okay. So angular acceleration. The angular acceleration is the rate of change of angular velocity. That is, alpha is equal to d square theta divided by dt square. Here we have another equation for alpha. Angular acceleration, alpha is equal to minus mb theta divided by I. But according to the equation, the angular acceleration alpha is the rate of change of angular velocity, that is d square theta divided by dt square. So we can give this equation number 5. Okay. So now compare the equation 4 and 5. Compare the equation 4 and 5. Here in the equation 4, we have alpha is equal to minus mb theta divided by I. And in equation 5, we have angular acceleration alpha is equal to d square theta by dt square. That is the rate of change of angular velocity of an object. So what about the LHS of both equation 4 and 5?
Alpha.
Both are same, right? So here we can equate equation number 4 and 5. So write the next step. Equate equation 4 and 5. So here we are going to equate our equation number 4 and 5. So we can write d square theta by dt square is equal to d square theta by dt square is equal to minus mb theta by I. Minus mb theta divided by I. Or you can take this minus mb theta I to the left hand side of the equation. So what will be it becomes? Here we are going to take this term minus mb theta by I to left side. So what is the equation becomes? Unmute and say.
I don't understand.
Here we are comparing the equation 4 and 5 dear. Equation 4, angular acceleration alpha is equal to minus mb theta divided by I. Okay, so this is the expression that we are get from our previous steps. But actually the angular acceleration, the actual angular acceleration means the rate of change of angular displacement. That is, alpha is equal to d square theta by dt square. So here we are going to compare this equation 4 and 5. Equation number 4 and equation number 5. What about the LHS of both equation?
Both are alpha.
Both are alpha. Both are angular acceleration. So can we equate these two terms?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So our equation becomes d square theta by dt square is equal to minus mb theta divided by I. Now I want to take this term to LHS. So what our equation become?
Minus mb theta by I equal to d square theta by dt square. Ma'am, I can't hear you.